from the reading that you have just completed, the Second World War ends, but not without controversy. And we're going to take a look at that in today's reading and activity and really culminate what we've discussed on this term, total war. So without further ado, let's go ahead and take a look at the concept and review the concept of total war once again. Right at the beginning of the unit, we started off defining what total war was. And the Second World War frequently has been described as sort of the best test case for what total war is. So let's go ahead and review some of those definitions. The first of which is that the size and scope of war dramatically increases. So I have this clip right here, or this table right here, talks about some of the greatest battles in Western history and sort of the day-to-day casualties that came about from these particular battles. What you'll notice from the Second World War is that the timing of these battles would dramatically increase. Again, as a result of the Industrial Revolution, you can supply with greater frequency than before, not just material, but also men as well. And as a result of this, the casualty numbers are enormous, in the millions, lasting months at a time. And if you're actually observing this quite intently, you'll notice that some of the worst battles in history happen to be on the Eastern Front. In other words, between Germany and the Soviet Union. Okay, so as a result of this, this in a lot of ways defines total war in just the sheer size and scope and the scale of this particular conflict. Okay? Not only that, but rich economies are going to orient their entire industries towards war. Okay? Entire production lines of tanks and aircraft are created, some of them brand new factories. Others have been reinstituted from creating consumer automobiles as such. Okay? Thirdly, the demonization of the enemy, that if you fight against somebody who you see as inhuman, you have an easier time killing them, making worse of them as such. And we see that frequently in this particular war, the last abandonment and restraints of combat. We examined this in the Holocaust in the previous activity, but then also those who would give up their entire lives in order to destroy an enemy target, the kamikaze bombers of the Japanese Air Force. And lastly, probably the one that we're going to focus on most today is that the civilians are targeted, not just as a target, but frequently a preferred target of war. So what we're going to start off with is this notion of strategic bombing. In other words, you take aircraft and you bomb people on the ground, particularly civilians, with the notion that they might actually, again, be the preferred targets. So instead of military targets, they are what they call soft targets, civilian targets. We're going to take a look at the history of this in this set of documents. So going back to your Google Classroom page, there's a PDF called Firestorms, the Bombing of Civilians in a 20th Century Warfare. Go and read through. And there are questions on the bottom half that you're going to go ahead and answer and write down. So take about, I would say, about 15, 20, 25 minutes to go ahead and complete this particular exercise. All right. Hopefully, what you're able to do is to come back and to examine this particular piece here. I'm going to go ahead and review some parts of it just for your sake here. The first of which is, look, early on, especially in the First World War, there was thought that this is wrong. This isn't what a war is supposed to be. And so there were rules and there were laws that said, look, maybe we shouldn't have aerial bombardment at all. However, when it was reused again in the Spanish Civil War in 1936 and 1937, the same ideas came out, that this was inhumane, that nobody would choose to do this. Okay? But as we get to the desperation of the Second World War, Britain, Germany, and eventually the United States will accept the notion of aerial bombardment to destroy the manufacturing and industrial resources of a state. In other words, this is just a different way to fight a war. You just try to prevent the ability of the enemy to actually conduct the war itself by eliminating supplies. Now, the U.S. really thought they could control this and in terms of who they bombed. They could actually just bomb the factories and then that was it. And so they bombed during the daytime. while the British, trying to prevent losses to their airmen and their aircraft, bombed during the nighttime, which was more indiscriminate, meaning you just bombed an area and if you get civilians, you get civilians. Eventually, over time, they found that this type of precision bombing that the U.S. was doing wasn't as effective as they would hope. And so by the time we get to 1944, 1945, particularly with the Japanese cities that were made out of predominantly wood, the U.S. turned to this type of bombing, firebombing, which basically burned major cities such as Tokyo, Yokohama, and other major industrial cities in Japan, through just simply indiscriminate, let's just firebomb the entire city. Upwards to about, in some cases, 50, 70, 80% of cities would be destroyed as a result of this firebombing. Okay. Now, something else to note in regards to total war, the Second World War saw from the rape of Nanjing to eventually the conquest of Berlin, city and urban fighting is some of the most destructive in human history. And you see that hopefully in that part of the writing. Now, I want to be able to help you to answer that last question, where it involves some part of the cost of city fighting, not just for men who are fighting, but then also civilians as well. And then also to add in the cost of a seaborne invasion. Okay, so this is again to set up your answer for question number 10, which we'll get to in just a moment here. Okay. Let me provide some samples of, in this war, there are frequently attempts to try to invade enemy territory by sea. This is costly, this not just in terms of men and cost, like you see in this particular event, the D-Day invasions of northern France, where the Western Allies finally come back to continental Europe, 95,100 casualties to get a few divisions of troops on the ground, involving, and we talk about the cost, in this case, it's the material cost, about 5,000 ships and 11,000 men aircraft needed in order to conduct this particular invasion. In other words, it's difficult to do. It's costly in terms of material, in terms of men as well. Okay. In the Pacific, there was a different type of cost as well, whereby the American invaders found that the Japanese would fight to the end. For example, in the Tarawa Atoll in 1943, really tiny, about 12 square miles in size, a massively larger American force will attack about 5,000 Japanese defenders. It was costly for the Americans, but when it comes to this particular cost, on both sides, when one side decides it needs and will fight to the end, according to the Japanese code of Bushido, the samurai code of old, you are supposed to fight to the end. You do not surrender. It's dishonorable to do so. In this particular case, all but 17 Japanese died in the defense of a small island hundreds of miles away from home. Okay. It gets worse. I mean, you've probably have seen this particular image here of that really is dedicated to the bravery of the men who fought on this tiny island called Iwo Jima here. Only about 8 square miles in size, about 650 nautical miles from Japan. In other words, it is within range of American fighter aircraft to reach Japan. About 110,000 Americans fought against 22,000 Japanese. Immense cost to the Americans and just about as bad for the Japanese when it comes to just sheer numbers. 21,000 plus out of 22,000. Only about 1,000 Japanese were captured in the end. Again, it's going to be costly for any seaborne invasion. And thus, the sacrifice of American Marines on this island is really depicted in this particular famous image. In Okinawa, the first home island of Japan that was invaded by the United States. It's relatively larger in size than the smaller ones that we've looked at, and a massive American invasion force was necessary to try to take these islands, resulting in tens of thousands of American casualties and tens of thousands of not just Japanese soldiers, but here's the other part of it, Japanese civilians, and many who were told in this racially charged war that the Americans were brutes that would rape their women and kill their kids and so forth. Thousands of Japanese would actually commit suicide rather than being caught by Americans. And so if this is going to be the cost, not just for the military, but also for civilians, what would this mean for the Japanese home islands, which is much larger in size, dozens of major objectives, so much so that some Americans estimated that it would kill about 5 to 10 million Japanese civilians and maybe about a million American casualties. And just to kind of put that in context, America had suffered about 1 million casualties in this war up to this point. So from 1941 to 1945, all the battles in Europe and Japan in the Pacific combined together was about a million casualties. Some will estimate that this number will double as a result. Others will say this is an overestimate. There are other things that are going on. For instance, and we'll get to this in the later part of the of our discussion, the Soviet Union has broken their non-aggression pact with Japan and is out to defeat the Japanese army in China, and perhaps that will end the war. Not only that, but Japan is a series of islands. What about a month-long, two, three-month-long naval blockade? Hey, to starve the Japanese citizenry out of out to surrender, hey, perhaps that would be a solution. So it's not as if an invasion was necessary, but perhaps there's one other possibility. And that is something that the United States have been working on since the beginning of the war. There has been discussion on in terms of using atomic power, the ability to split the atom, which if you do split the atom, all of a sudden it produces all sorts of energy. And in this massively expensive project nicknamed the Manhattan Project, the United States successfully developed the first atomic weapon, a single bomb that can really literally destroy a city. The new president at this point, Harry Truman, who has taken over after Franklin Delano Roosevelt died, decides that he is going to use the bomb and in as a means to try to get Japan to surrender. There's talk about maybe dropping the bomb on the sea for all of Japan to see. There's talk about maybe at least giving a specific message to Japan saying, like, we have this weapon of massive destruction. We will use it if you don't surrender. There's talk of this. But Truman says, look, it's war. We're going to use the resources available to us. And on August 6th, 1945, there is the decision that's made to drop the bomb on Japan. The target that's selected is one of the last major cities that have been unhit by American bombers. And the bomber, the Enola Gay, which is actually named after Paul Tibbet, the pilot's grandmother, is sent forth to drop the bomb. And so with that, there is a video clip that if you go back to Google Classroom, take a look at just what this may have looked like. Not just this, but then also what some of the reactions of the crew as well in this particular video. So go and take a look at this before we respond further. So go and pause the video, come back to another one. There's also a series of other ones. If you take a look at it, if you want to take a look at and watch that, feel free to do so. So the bomb itself eventually is going to have a dramatic effect, but Japan does not respond. And so 3 days later, the only other bomb that the United States had, a plutonium bomb, was dropped on the city of Nagasaki, and it would take a month just about before, and really intervention from the Japanese emperor before Japan decides to surrender. So with that, what we're going to take a look at is this here. After viewing the video, reflecting on the readings in this packet and the notes in the PowerPoint, do you believe that it was necessary for America to drop the bomb? So in a multi-sentence response, make sure you have not just a yes or no answer, but an explanation of why or why not, based upon all the things that you've read, whether it's the acceptance of strategic bombing on civilians, the usage of a atomic bomb, the cost of invasion, or just simply the ability to save American lives, whatever it might be, make an explanation for whether or not you believe the bomb should be dropped. Okay, guys, have a good one. I'll catch you next time.